Almost single-handedly, one of these three women created the sport of female bodybuilding. Number one, what is your name, please?
My name is Corey Everson.
Number two.
My name is Corey Everson.
Number three.
My name is Corey Everson.
Only one of these people is the real Corey Everson, and is the only one sworn to tell the truth. Now let's meet our panel. Co-star of Murder, She Wrote, Ron Mazak. From Night Court, Kathy McCauley. Film and television producer David Niven Jr. And to tell the truth's very own Kitty Carlisle. Here's the host of To Tell the Truth, Alex Trebek.
Thank you, Burton. Obviously, I was inspired by the three women who make up our first team of challengers. Good morning, panel.
Good morning. Y'all.
Ready for this one?
Oh, yes.
Y'all in shape?
Uh-huh.
All right, follow along as I read the affidavit. I, Corey Everson, played a major role in making female bodybuilding into a respectable sport. Before I won my 6 Ms. Olympia titles, women who engaged in the sport were looked upon as sideshow curiosities. Not anymore. For I'm proof positive that women can be muscular and feminine. In college, I was a 4-time champion pentathlete. It was then that I began to realize that exercise can build self-esteem and accomplishment. In addition, my philosophy has enabled me to host a popular television show, build a successful sportswear company, and produce videos on fitness. Soon you will be seeing me playing a new role, a villain in the movie Double Impact. So watch out, Clint Eastwood. I can make your day. Signed, Corey Everson. We'll find out a lot more about this Arnold Schwarzenegger of female bodybuilders after this. Now, these three ladies all claim to be Corey Everson, premier bodybuilder. Kitty, we'll start with you.
Thank you. Number one, I didn't realize this was a sport.
Yes, there's numerous magazines on modern bodybuilding.
Oh, I knew that. Number two, when you won your titles Ms. Olympia titles, what sort of things did you do?
Well, first of all, the preliminary segment of the competition, or show as we call it, it's just a major lineup with the other contestants, and then you do compulsory posing. And after that, you do a routine where
you
choreograph it.
Number three, do you believe in swimming?
Yes.
Oh, good. I like to swim, too.
David?
Number one, as a matter of interest, why was it not a respectable sport until you turned it into one?
It's still a hard sport to accept. My father has a hard time with me in this sport myself, so...
Thank you. Number two, how many years of training did you have to go through before you won your first Miss Olympia?
Well, I won my first Miss Olympia in 84, and I started out with other competitions, of course, and I started really seriously training about 1980.
And number three, how many sports did you have to compete in the pentathlon?
5.
Just checking.
Kathy?
Number one, tell me about your diet right before competition.
It starts off with about 700 to 800 calories, high protein, high carbohydrate, no fat, no sodium.
Thank you. Number two, do men ever feel intimidated because you might be, like, bigger than them?
Some men do, sure. I think it's becoming more and more accepted, though.
And number three, what kind of character do you play in the movie that's coming out?
I'm an evil villain, a murderer.
Do you get to flex your muscles?
No, I don't. I get to flex my guns and my knives.
Oh, sounds good.
That sounds pretty good to me. Ron.
Number one, the men have weight classes. Do the ladies have weight classes as well?
Yes, they do. They do in the amateur ranks, which is where I started, lightweight, middleweight, heavyweight. When you get into the professional ranks, there's no weight classes at all.
Number two, who was the most famous Mr. Olympia?
Arnold.
Number three, there was a very famous runner-up in the Mr. Olympia contest all those years. Do you know who that would be?
Franco Colombo was one, and also Frank Zane.
They were all so good, weren't they? And now you have the difficult task of casting your ballots for the one you feel is the real Corey Everson. Is it number one? Is it number two? Or is it number three? This team of challengers will receive $500 for each incorrect vote, with a minimum guarantee of $1,000. And if our panel is fooled completely, then this team will receive $3,000. Kitty, for whom did you cast your
number
vote?
Number one had more information than anybody, and I'm sure it was all correct. But number three has a kind of posture that tells me she's an athlete, and I hope I'm right.
All righty. A vote for number three. David.
Well, I thought number one had the posture and looked like an athlete, but I happen to have agreed with Kitty because I thought that number three was brilliant when she came up with Franco Colombo's name, who I also happen to know, and I thought, you get my vote on that.
Remember, though, our imposters are usually very well briefed.
That's true, but yes. Not on runner-ups.
Aha. Kathy?
Well, I think they're all three beautiful, but I'm going to say number one because I know that bodybuilders always have a tan.
They always have a tan?
Yes, that makes your body look more toned, and trust me.
Not done with makeup, huh, Ron?
No.
Let me tell you how good they are trained by our staff. I eliminated number three right away because she said that swimming. And most of my life, I heard that people who do weights really don't swim because it uses different muscles. Then she turned around and knew Franco Colombo, but I was looking for Lou Ferrigno. So she came up with a name that I did know as well. But I avoided that. I went with number one.
Ron, that made no sense
at all. Of course not.
Two votes for number one, no votes for number two, and two votes also for number three. So let's find out now, ladies and gentlemen, who the six-time Ms. Olympia is. Will the real Corey Everson please stand up? It is number three. Oh, boy. Corey, has it changed a great deal? Are we learning to accept muscular women?
I think with people like, the new Janet Jackson and Cher and Madonna and Heather Locklear and these celebrity superstars that are also promoting weight training and fitness, I think that the general public now accepts bodybuilding not only as a sport but mostly as an activity, just to go to the gym and get yourself into great shape.
Also, it's an activity that helps promote good health, and everybody should be in favor of that. You guys were great. Let's find out about our imposters. Number one, who are you?
My name is Rhonda Jorgensen, and I'm an account representative for a men's wholesale sweater company.
Well, nice having you with us today. Number two, who are you?
My name's Deborah Martin, and I'm an attorney in the LA area.
Los Angeles attorney. Two incorrect votes, ladies, at $500 apiece, and that means the team will receive $1,000. And we thank you so much for being with us today on To Tell the Truth.
Thank you.
We'll be back with a woman whose daughter was killed by the Manson family. Serious stuff right after this. Gentlemen, let's meet our next group of challengers.
Number one, what is your name, please?
My name is Doris Tate.
Number two.
My name is Doris Tate.
Number three.
My name is Doris Tate.
It's up to our panelists to find the real Doris Tate, and even after these many years, it's still a very upsetting story. Please follow along as I read the affidavit. I, Doris Tate, am the mother of actress Sharon Tate. For years after my pregnant daughter and six others were brutally murdered by the Manson family, I was immobilized by grief. But when the parole hearings began for Sharon's killers, I realized my destiny was to speak out for those who couldn't, the victims. I began circulating petitions, and each time a killer appeared for a parole hearing, I was able to present hundreds of thousands of signatures urging their continued imprisonment. I am a director of Parents of Murdered Children, a group that consoles and seeks justice for people who have lost a child to criminal violence. I speak to the inmates in prisons about the pain and suffering they inflict upon the families of the victims. My friends wish I'd put the horror behind me, but I can't. Families of victims can and must survive. Signed, Doris Tate. Ron, we'll start the questioning with you on this very serious subject.
My heart goes out to you. When someone is sentenced, as Charles Manson was, to life imprisonment without hope of parole, number one, why does he come up for parole so often?
They are allowed to come up for parole every 7 years.
Every 7 years. Number
yes.
two, how many different prisons are the Manson and Aikens and the rest of them, how many different prisons do you have to visit during this time?
Three.
Number three, where did the tragedy happen?
It happened in Benedict Canyon, Cielo Drive.
Number one.
Kathy.
Number one, how do you feel with all the coverage that Manson gets and all these different exploitation kind of shows, always interviewing him? How does that make you feel?
Not great.
And number three, did you have to go through therapy yourself?
Actually, no. I withdrew for 3 years, practically. I had no association with anybody at all. And then it actually took me 10 years to get over it. And I'm not over it, but... 10 years.
David?
Thank you. Number one, parents of murdered children. How many people are there in this association?
Well, I don't really know the exact number, but there's a lot of them.
All right. How long has this been going for? Number two, please.
Since 1976.
Okay. And number three, are there a lot of children who get murdered?
I don't know the statistics. I know that there's like 1,800... across the country that belong to this organization, 1,800 parents that belong.
I see. Number one, when you're talking to the inmates in prison, what is their reaction when you're lecturing them? Do they care, or are they sorry, or what?
No, they don't know me, and they don't care what happened to my daughter.
But, Kitty?
Well, number two, to follow up on that question, I think what David meant was, do you feel that you're doing any good? Do they become penitent when you talk to these... inmates who've murdered children?
Well, I can't speak for all of them because...
But you have had some
when
success.
When I go in, I don't know, you know, what they have done.
But you do talk to them?
Oh, yes.
Number three, when this thing first happened, how many were there in the Manson family who were the murderers?
Well, actually, at Sharon's, there were three people went there. Tex Watson, Sharon, Susan Atkins, and Patricia Krenwinkel, and then Linda Kasabian was also there, but she was the lookout. She stayed outside and looked.
Number two, do you go to other people's paroles? For instance, Squeaky Fromm, has she come up for parole?
No, I don't go to them. Just the one that killed my daughter.
Time's up. You have to cast your votes for the woman you feel is the real mother of Sharon Tate. Is it number one? Is it number two? Or is it number three? Ron?
They were all so well prompted and taught. My heart went out to all three of the ladies. For whatever reason, number two can kind of nodded at certain things that's a good point to get across. And somewhere in your eyes, number two, I see Sharon.
Kathy?
I thought they were all great, too, and my heart goes out to every single one of them. And I would say, though, I thought number three.
David?
Well, I agree with you. I want you to know I thought it was number three. Number three is beautiful, and so is your daughter.
Kitty?
It could be any one of them, and it's a terrible story. I voted for number two.
Alrighty, let's review the votes. No votes for number one, two votes for number two, two votes also for number three. And now we'll find out who the real voice of the victim is. Will the real Doris Tate please stand up? It is number two. Mrs. Tate, you've been at this for a long time, and as we all indicated, it's a very serious subject, but you have managed to console a number of other people, and as a matter of fact, you have helped found an organization that has to do with victims' rights. Can you tell us about that briefly?
Yes, it's Coalition on Victims Equal Rights. We are in six different regions now throughout California, and in those six regions, we have seven attorneys available for victims.
Do you find that all too often victims are forgotten because as soon as the crime is committed, and the victim is killed, that person is gone, and all of the publicity, all of the news reports have to do with those who are still alive, the families and the criminals. Is that really part of the problem?
That is part of the problem, and that's why I take on this responsibility, because Sharon's case is probably, next to Kennedy's, one of the most infamous cases in the United States.
Well, it's good having you here today. Let's meet our imposters, who are good, too. Number one, who are you, ma'am?
My name is Ruth Reedy, and I'm a volunteer at San Antonio Community Hospital, and I'll be celebrating my 50th wedding anniversary in June.
Well, congratulations. That's terrific. Number three, there were two incorrect votes for you.
My name is Elizabeth Woods, and I volunteer on cruise ships.
Volunteer at cruise ships. Two incorrect votes at $500 apiece, and that means the team will receive $1,000. And we thank you for being with us today on To Tell the Truth. We'll be back to play one-on-one right after this. Burton, who have you got today for one-on-one?
Well, today, Alex, we have someone from my hometown of Portland, Oregon, Mr. Keith Hansen. Keith? Oh, here he is.
Keith from Portland.
Come on
out
here, Keith.
Step out there, get yourself positioned, and get ready to try to win $500 in cash. I want you to meet a young lady with two stories to tell. Ladies and gentlemen, please greet Kara Cohen. Keith, this young lady is going to tell us two stories. One of them is true. You spot the true story, and you will win $500. Kara, what's your first story?
I am in a new movie with Macaulay Culkin from Home Alone. I play his girlfriend.
Okay, now that may not be the truth, Keith. Let's listen to story number two. Kara?
I dust floors with my feet. I invented a booty that dusts as you walk.
Oh, little dust booties. All right, well, let's get one question from each of our panelists on, first of all, the story about co-starring with Macaulay Culkin.
Kara, is he as cute on in person as he seems to be on the screen?
Yes.
David.
Okay. I assume this is a love story. Do you kiss him?
At the end of the movie, I do. But we're not filming right now. We're filming next week.
I see.
All right, Kathy?
Do you know how to do his famous scream?
What?
Do you know how to do his
Oh, yes.
Can you do it?
Okay.
No demonstrations.
Oh, okay.
No demonstrations on the program.
Aww.
Even of other people's routines. Ron?
You are very pretty. Who plays the mother in this movie?
I haven't met all the grown-ups in the movie right now. We're doing it next week. All I know right now is that me and Macaulay are going to do it.
Good enough for me.
Don't you love that line? I haven't met all of the grown-ups in this film. Let's get to story number two. That this young lady invented these dust booties. Kitty.
Kara, darling, why do you care about dusting floors at your age?
Oh, I just wanted to help my mother with the floor. It was a project for school.
I see. Thank you.
David.
Are these booties for parents to wear or for other energetic children?
One size fits all.
Kathy?
How did you come up with this idea?
I wanted to think of a way to help my mother and all mothers across America.
Aww.
Ron?
Let's put in a real good plug. How much do they cost?
Well, if I did sell them, I'd sell them for $15 each.
Oh!
All right, Keith. From Portland, Oregon, you've heard the cross-examination. Serious stuff here. Is Kara in this new Macaulay Culkin film, or did she invent dust booties?
She looks like the inventor type, so I'm going to go for the booties.
All right. Kara Cohen, what's your true story?
Well, to tell the truth, I invented dust booties.
Good for you. And good for you, too, Keith. $500 in cash, and our thanks for playing one-on-one. Kara? Would you come over here and give us a demonstration of the dust booties so that we can see? Oh, look at this. Isn't this spectacular? One size fits all. Who gets to wear these at the house?
We just let anybody use them.
Anybody gets to use them. Do you have more than one pair at your home?
Yes.
You do. Would you like me to help you here?
Oh, no, thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. I was just being polite. Here, slip this on your right foot. Did you get any kind of a reward for coming up with this great invention?
No, we just got a medal.
You got a medal?
Well, not really a medal. It's like kind of like an award.
Well, I'll tell you something. If you were my daughter and you'd invented this, your allowance would have gone up By a big amount. All right, let's see what you do.
Okay, I have a song.
You have a song?
Oh, Dust Booties, Dust Booties, Dust will be all gone. Oh, what fun it is to clean with a pair of Dust Booties on. Dust Booties, Dust Booties, Dust will be all gone. Oh, what fun it is to clean with a pair of Dust Booties on.
A walking mop. Kara, that was terrific. Thank you. We'll take a break, ladies and gentlemen. We'll come back after the set out, and there's a lot of dust on the floor. We better get Kara back in here. We'll see you all next time. Come on, Kara. Dust your way over here.